Hey, what's up? This is Trivium. For me right now, I'd say betrayer. I think if there's a why, looking back at such a mixture of the broad range of influences of musical styles we love so much, from metal, but also outside of metal, and I feel like we've never had a song that's as wide in scope of influence in one.
Probably Beyond Oblivion, just because it's fast, it's brutal, and it's just so meat and potatoes. It's like just right to the point, and
what he likes is meat.
Yeah.
Just, you know, really intense song, and it's, you know, especially with, you know, Alex's drumming being pretty teched out and crazy, it's something, you know, people have never heard us kind of that element in a song before.
I can't exactly remember what made me write down the sin in the sentence, but I was definitely listening to the demo I had, like, on a flight home, and it just clicked for some reason. I've never really come up with a screaming part for a song, and I showed Matt, and it seemed to work perfectly. And then it became the title after we saw the artwork, which was like, that's a whole other thing. We just like went through a few title changes, then we saw the artwork, and we were like, it's definitely gonna be the album title now too.
Yeah, originally the record was gonna be called The Revanchist, with a whole different set of art. Then it shifted to Trivium, with a different set of art. Then it shifted last minute to the sin of the sentence as soon as we saw the symbol.
I'd probably go with The Rising. That was sort of like a last minute thing when we were doing The Crusade. And what pisses me off about the song is that it kicked off another song that I liked way more, which was Broken One. We're at a weird point, and I think when we had the song Anthem written for The Crusade, I remember when we were all kind of talking, everyone was really excited about the song. And I think maybe there was a suggestion about, hey, try something like Anthem, you know, maybe get another song like that. It really wasn't cohesive, like, idea of like what the record was gonna be.
Follow the label on that one for a little bit.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it was a follow-up to something that we'd never had.
That record taught us a lot. It taught us a lot of things. Like, we actually went through and realized, let's not do that again. Like writing during, quote, writing time. Like, having a set amount of time that we were allowed to write and a set amount of time that we had to go to the studio. And that's what The Crusade was during a very dysfunctional point of our band. There are several songs on that song that I wish I feel like they're kind of incomplete. I might go with The Rising as well, her least favorite.
The ideas were there, but I think
execution.
We just didn't have enough time to really fully realize the song, so listening to the song, you're just like, yeah, we shouldn't have done that, or like, if we had more time, it probably would have not ended up that way. We don't write the same album all the time, so it's like every time we do a record, there's always something fun and interesting to dive into musically, lyrically, vocally, that it's something we haven't done, so it doesn't feel like we're just like, it's like deja vu or something. There's always some fun new thing that we get into that, you know, challenges us as writers and as a band. And we just love playing live as well. So, you know, being able to go out on tour as much as we do to create a fan base, you know, really helps, you know, especially when we started off, you know, we were pretty much, our bread and butter was, you know, making fans on the road. So luckily we love traveling and playing music.
I feel like our old records, I love them a lot, and I just want to keep pushing ourselves to keep making that kind of quality music and seeing where it goes.
Anything Japanese for me. Anything Japanese.
I feel like shit, but I mean, I'd eat pizza every day if I could.
I love eating sushi, but that's probably not the best thing to eat every single day.
I'd do sushi every day if I could.
And a gallon
and
of
ice cream.
Oh yeah, and ice cream.
Probably when our in-ears have, what do you call it? Like interference?
Yeah.
That shit sucks. It's just like white noise hitting
remember
you.
Remember that show where you like actually got blown out of your
shoes? Yeah. It wasn't interference on the wireless. It was actually like electricity, like overloading the wireless. And it was like the loudest noise I've ever heard. And I like literally jumped out of my shoes.
What?
Yeah, I remember. I forget how it happened, but
you it did.
I have a big comic book collection, black metal t-shirts, obviously. Limited edition soda from Japan. Alien toys, Power Ranger toys as a kid. Every tour ever, I've always grabbed one of every single thing, and I have a stockpile of one of everything.
For me, it's like I just keep all the tickets for flights I've had since like the beginning of touring.
I didn't know that.
So I have like a stack of them. Like I have like stuff back to like first trip to like Australia and everything. And obviously, I'm sure everyone keeps like the tour passes. Yeah, I don't know why the flight ticket thing I just started doing, and I continue to do it to this day, and I have tons of them. It's kind of weird to see like every flight you've taken like in a pile, then you really start to realize how much you've traveled.
Corey has a shitload of guitars.
Yeah, I guess that's an occupational hazard. I don't like go out of my way on tour to go like find and buy guitars, but just over the years I've bought some guitars as, you know, just stuff I've wanted or just from endorsements and stuff.
Swords, and man.
I never sold any of them, so I have like, you know, almost like 70 something, 80 guitars.
You got the swords, the KBC swords.
I got a lot of Home Shopping Network buying knife sets.
drunk purchase.
I've got a diabetic French bulldog named Miyuki. She's a little bit past 9 years old. I've never had anything I've taken care of, so she's extremely spoiled. She's on a prescription diet now. She was diagnosed with diabetes about 3-ish years ago. Ironically, ever since getting diabetes, she's been healthier than ever. She's more fit than ever. She looks like she's like a year old, and all she does is run around outside. It's pretty amazing.
I have a 2-year-old pit bull. Her name is Brooklyn, and she is my wife and I's world. Yeah, it's my baby.
My cat is Mr. Brown. He's very famous. People like him on Instagram. Yeah, pretty much. He replaced me as my mom's son. And she takes care of him and is very protective of the cat. He lives with them, but I go see him often when I'm at home. And if you know Trivium, you definitely know him. Definitely Callisto on Shogun was a tricky one.
I think any difficulties in the studio was probably something from Shogun.
There's yeah, like some of those that were like definitely.
What was the song that I had to take a break on?
Callisto.
Yeah. Like, that was probably the hardest one to track, like most frustrating for like.
It's always
everyone.
A Corey riff. Corey writes some weird riffs sometimes. There's at least a Corey riff or five on every record that's really difficult to play.
I think like on the new record, you know, there's definitely technical stuff and it was tough to play, but we played it so much that we made sure every riff felt right to play, whereas I think even on like Shogun, we were still at that point where we were kind of like, I don't know, we weren't as mindful of like, oh, we're gonna have to actually play this stuff. And sometimes you can alter things to make it a little bit more playable and maybe even more musical and better. And that riff was just really tricky because it like moves in this like weird pattern. And everyone was, I remember Matt and Nick,
yeah,
producer, got into like an argument about it. And but it got done, ended up sounding great.
So I kept trying it, and it just kept getting worse. It was like, give me 5 minutes, and I left the studio, and I came back, and he was having Corey track it instead.
Definitely the travel. I like seeing all the different spots of the world, and you eat so much good food. We made a lot of good friends, and when you know people in different places, it makes going back to them even more fun, because then it feels familiar. And, you know, we just keep getting to go to all these cool places that we've never thought we'd go, like playing South Africa, you know, going to Australia all the time, going to Japan, South America, and even playing in the States. I mean, it's just such a big country. There's always something new to discover, and it's a fun time. Yeah, playing to different crowds all over.
The food, being able to learn about a culture or a people through their food, that's the greatest thing in the world. I mean, you know, we see band guys, because it can be hard sometimes. I mean, everything you do in life is hard, but this is basically like a paid vacation. You get to go everywhere and play music and find whatever you can find. It's amazing.
And we get to write, record, perform exactly the kind of music we want to hear as fans of metal. So, you know, just having that freedom to just, you know, write and do whatever you want with your music and then be able to share it with people and people enjoying it and going out and play it and seeing people scream all along to the songs that you spent hours, you know, trying to make great. Yeah.
And you get free booze. And, you know, just being able to do what you love to do for a living, you know, there's nothing better than that.
It's like Forrest Gump gets all the free ice cream he wants.
Yeah, exactly.
Make sure you guys pick up our new album, The Sin and the Sentence, out October 20th. Maybe you were right, maybe I was wrong. Silent for far too long.